We are going to talk about the stress response system. So the stress response system, actually there's kind of two sort of different arms of the stress response system. So on the left of this picture, you see the sympathoadrenomedullary system. And on the right, you see the HPA axis, which we just kind of were talking a little bit about. I'm going to talk about the sympathoadrenomedullary system first. So basically with this sympathoadrenomedullary system, the brain is going to interpret signals, whether they're external or internal. And in either case, the brain is going to interpret internal or external signals, real or perceived, and then it's going to activate the sympathoadrenomedullary system and the HPA axis. So this is our response to stress. Doesn't matter what kind it is. Remember, that's sort of the key to this. It doesn't matter what kind it is. It just matters that it's there. So the sympathoadrenomedullary system is really considered the short-term stress response. And so this is like the you're running for your life kind of a deal. And the reason why it's so profound is because these catecholamines, which you can see there. So if you see, again, I don't have a cursor. You see on the left of our screen, we have a nerve that leaves the brain, essentially, leaves the central nervous system. It's going to travel down the spinal cord. It's going to exit the spinal cord, and it's going to travel the distance to the adrenal glands, which sit on top of our kidneys. And then you see that nerve synapses or communicates with the adrenal gland. In this case, you can see it's communicating with the inside of the adrenal gland, the inner portion, which is called the adrenal medulla. And this is why this is called the sympathoadrenomedullary. So it's the sympathetic nervous system that initiates this. This is a sympathetic neuron that's leaving the central nervous system, and it's traveling to the adrenal medulla. And when it synapses with the adrenal medulla, it causes the adrenal medulla to secrete into the blood the catecholamines, epinephrine and norepinephrine. So they're secreted into the blood. These are called you can call them hormones or neurohormones. I think either one is probably neurohormone is more appropriate. But they're being secreted into the blood. And hormones, or neurohormones in this case, these are communicating molecules. This is the way our body communicates over a distance. It utilizes either the nervous system or the endocrine system. And so these hormones, or neurohormones, epinephrine and norepinephrine, are secreted into the blood, and they're going to travel all around. They're going to get pumped through the circulatory system, through the blood supply, and they're going to bind to receptors wherever we have receptors for epinephrine and norepinephrine, which turns out to be in a lot of places. And as a result of this, we're going to see a very profound, and this is instantaneous, like this is super, super fast. We're going to see a very fast response, and it's going to look like an increase in heart rate, an increase in blood pressure. A whole bunch of glucose is going to move into the blood. The liver is going to convert glycogen, which is our storage form of glucose, and glucose will be released into the blood. We're going to open up our airways. We're going to change our blood flow patterns. It's going to lead to more alertness, so more blood flow to your brain, more blood flow to your skeletal muscles, which is not on there, but it should be. Not as much blood flow to places like your digestive system. You know, we move blood, not as much blood flow. We don't filter as much through our kidneys, so we don't urinate as much, and we see an increase in a metabolic rate. And this is fast, and this is profound. This is fight or flight, right? This is a big deal. You can't miss a fight or flight response. So that's called the sympathoadrenomedullary system. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a second. The flip side of this is the HPA axis, which we'll talk about at the end. And in this case, you see the brain, the hypothalamus is up there at the top. We'll talk more details about this. And the hypothalamus essentially causes the release of a couple hormones, one of which is CRH, which is corticotropin-releasing hormone. That happens to go into a little blood supply. I'll show you a picture of that later, a little vascular bed. And it travels to the anterior pituitary, which is a gland in our just below the hypothalamus in our brain. There's certain cells in the anterior pituitary called corticotrope cells. which are sensitive to corticotropin-releasing hormone. And when a corticotropin-releasing hormone, or CRH, binds to one of those cells, that causes adrenocorticotropic hormone, which is ACTH, to release into the blood. And then it's going to travel in the blood to the adrenal cortex, the outside of the adrenal gland, and it's going to cause the adrenal cortex to release adrenal hormones, stress hormones, mostly glucocorticoids, the little green dots in that picture, and also some mineral corticoids. This is not going to be as fast, so this is considered the long-term stress response. You can see what the glucocorticoids are going to do is on the bottom of that picture on the right-hand side with all the arrows, the manufacturing of new glucose, more sugar into this blood, which is called gluconeogenesis, the decrease in insulin sensitivity. So remember, the job of insulin is to get sugar out of our blood. And when the insulin receptors lose sensitivity to insulin as a result of stress, the sugar stays in the blood. Remember, when you're having a stress response, this is not time to build. Glucose is a building. You know, it's something that we put into our cells and we make energy out of, but it kind of is expensive. It's energy dependent process. When you're dealing with stress, that's not the time to be making a whole bunch of stuff. So all that stuff stays in the blood, right? So we inhibit that. So it makes sense, right? This starts to make sense why people with chronic stress have so many issues with their blood sugar. We see a decrease in growth hormone for the same reason, a decrease in thyroid hormone, right? Especially the active thyroid hormone, which we see a lot in people that have stress-related illnesses. They have thyroid problems. And decrease in the immune response, the inflammatory response, and also an increase in fat and protein metabolism. The mineral corticoids are less exciting, but they cause us to retain sodium and water by our kidneys, and that will cause an increase in blood volume and blood pressure. I think we talked a little bit about that in the last lecture. So that's a lot. That's a lot of stuff that we've just talked about. So we're going to separate those and talk about them a little bit more, starting with the sympathomedullary system. So again, the brain is going to interpret our internal and external signals, like I said, as a potential threat. And then that interpretation will trigger, the way the brain interprets that will trigger both the sympathoadrenal medullary system and also the HPA axis. The most immediate response, as we said, occurs when the sympathetic nervous system signals that adrenal medulla through nerve impulses. That's almost instantaneous, right? Which you've all experienced, I'm sure, a fight or flight response. It's not like there's a big lag time between when you see the, you know, dog baring its teeth at you and you start running, right? You don't stand there and think about it for a while. You're on the way. Like, you already know, like, immediately your brain knows that's a threat. You need to get the heck out of there. And you're, you know, running like crazy. That's the fight or flight, right? Again, the adrenal medulla is going to release catecholamines, and those are epinephrine and norepinephrine, into the blood. Remember, another word for epinephrine is adrenaline, and noradrenaline for norepinephrine. And again, this is the fight or flight response. Now, there's a lot more detail to that we're not necessarily going to go into, but I do want to talk about, a little bit about a part of the brain called, or another kind of system called, the locus coeruleus norepinephrine system. Now, this is kind of detailed and certainly not going to be tested on this, but I think it's so interesting that I wanted to bring it up. So the locus coeruleus norepinephrine system describes a concentration of a concentrated nucleus of norepinephrine containing neurons located in the pons of the brain. So where you see that arrow pointing to the locus coeruleus there, that is in the pons of the brain. That's where that is. The pons is between the brainstem and the medulla oblongata, or the midbrain and the medulla oblongata, pardon me. So these neurons basically control or innervate. The term innervate means like to send neuron projections to an area and kind of control its action via nervous activity. So these neurons in the locus coeruleus innervate most of the central nervous system, especially the forebrain, and they're the sole source of neurons. So see those arrows coming out of the see the arrow that all those blue arrows leaving the locus coeruleus and kind of going up to the upper part of the brain. So that these neurons innervate most of the central nervous system, especially the forebrain, and they're the sole source of norepinephrine to the hippocampus and to the neocortex. And you can see that there. The neocortex on the top left and the hippocampus just above the locus coeruleus. This kind of explains why we see so much such a heightened sensory experience when somebody has a fight or flight response. Right, their senses are like so alive and alert, right? Their sense of, they see better, they smell better, like everything is, all their ability to sense is so, so acute. And this can be explained by this locus coeruleus norepinephrine system. Those locus coeruleus neurons are also stimulated by signals that are sent from the amygdala, the prefrontal cortex, the medulla, and the hypothalamus. And this creates an almost instant hyperarousal state of vigilance that allows the brain to respond immediately to a potential threat. And think about this, right? Like you guys have, I'm sure you've been in a situation where all of a sudden there's something that, you know, like if you're walking at night, this happened to me just recently. I was walking at night in a place where I shouldn't have been walking, most likely alone. And I just had a sense of somebody else around, but I couldn't really see them. And it was just kind of a weird situation. And of course, that's going to precipitate a fight or flight response, right? But it was like everything. Like I was so, I could hear so acutely, right? All of my senses were just tuned in to the situation in this state of like hyper arousal, vigilance. That would have allowed me, if it was a true threat, which it wasn't, I would have been able to respond immediately and very efficiently to that potential threat, or that threat, if it was not a potential threat, if it was a real threat. Interestingly, dysfunctions in the locus coeruleus are thought to be players in both hyper and hypoarousal. So some examples of potentially hyperarousal would be attention deficit disorder, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and potentially maybe post-traumatic stress disorder. Hypoarousal, we think of classically narcolepsy, the uncontrollable urge to sleep, and some other sleep disorders as well. There's a whole lot about the system that we just don't get, that we really don't know much about, right? This is an area that we're just kind of learning. Really, the brain is kind of mysterious to us because it's very much inaccessible, right? We don't have it's not like people are super excited about having their brains experimented on. And a lot of this kind of stuff, we do animal research, but you can't really tell if an animal is feeling more vigilant, right? That's not information we can gather necessarily from the animal. So it makes research pretty difficult. Okay, so that's the sympathoadrenal medullary system and the locus coeruleus norepinephrine system. And those kind of go together. What I want to spend the rest of our time kind of trying to figure out is the HPA axis, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. So stress signals are going to be consolidated within the hypothalamus and result ultimately in the releasing of different chemicals, which oftentimes are called secretagogues, from the hypothalamus. Now we're focusing specifically on stress, so we're going to kind of focus specifically on what's on this slide. So what you see up there is the different types of information is being relayed to the hypothalamus. There's kind of two regions in the hypothalamus that we're going to talk more about. One is called the paraventricular nucleus, which you see there in purple, kind of right in the middle of our slide. And the other is the supraoptic nuclei, which is not on that picture, I don't believe. Nope, we don't have it on this picture. So circadian information, stressors, all those sorts of, that sort of information is relayed to the paraventricular nucleus in the hypothalamus. So the hypothalamus then is going to release these two secretagogues. One is CRH and the other is AVP, which you can see there in the blue box in the middle. CRH stands for corticotropin releasing hormone, and AVP stands for arginine vasopressin. So both of these are going to be released from the hypothalamus, and they're going to travel to the anterior pituitary. So underneath, which is kind of dangling down there, is the anterior pituitary. The pituitary has like three sections. One is the anterior, one is the posterior, and then there's like an intermediate. I'll show you a better picture in a moment. The hypothalamus is connected to the anterior pituitary by a little vascular bed, a bed of blood vessels, which you see there. And it's called, there's a portal vein. A portal vein is basically a vein that connects two capillaries. So CRH and AVP are secreted from the hypothalamus into that little vascular bed, and then they're going to travel in that vascular bed. They don't have to go far. It's literally right there, to the anterior pituitary. And mostly CRH. AVP will do it a little bit, but mainly CRH is going to then stimulate the release of ACTH, which stands for adrenocorticotropic hormone. So ACTH is going to be released from the anterior pituitary, and it's going to be released into the blood, and it's going to travel to the adrenal cortex, and it's going to stimulate the production of corticosteroids from the adrenal cortex. The adrenal cortex is the outside, and that picture, the pinkish kind of coral color part, that's the adrenal cortex. The inside was the adrenal medulla. That's controlled by the sympathetic nervous system. So the HPA axis is hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal, and this is, again, what's kind of governs the long-term stress response. So glucocorticoids are the name of the stress hormones that are released. In humans, the stress hormone is called cortisol, primarily the predominant stress hormone. In rodents, it's called corticosterone, which you see there. So this is a rodent diagram, but it's the same setup, same exact thing. Remember we talked about cilia and the rats and all that. So these glucocorticoids in humans, it would be called cortisol, are responsible for basically making sure that there's enough energy available to maintain you through this long-term stress response. So they're responsible for the mobilization, peripheral mobilization, so into the blood, of glucose, fats, and amino acids into the blood. So you have enough fuel to survive. There's another adrenal hormone, we'll look at a picture in a little bit, called DHEA, or dehydroepiandrosterone, which is that's always a hard one to say. DHEA is also produced by the adrenal cortex, and it's kind of stimulated by ACTH, and it's sort of interesting because it seems like it kind of has a counter effect, so it kind of buffers the effects of cortisol on our cells. So if cortisol is really high, DHEA might be kind of secreted to kind of buffer that. So let me turn the slide here. So this one's an easier, it's kind of a weird picture, but it's an easier one to kind of understand. So a key feature of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis is this kind of a pretty complex negative feedback system. This picture makes it look pretty easy. So when glucocorticoids are released, and so you see cortisol down there at the bottom, glucocorticoids are released from the adrenal gland. When the cortisol levels are high, then that should down-regulate both the hypothalamus and the pituitary, right? If you have a lot of cortisol in your blood, you don't need to keep putting more of it there. So basically the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary, they drive the production of cortisol. So if there's a lot of it around, then we're going to see an inhibition of both the hypothalamus and the pituitary. So that's when we talked earlier about they down-regulate. So that's what we're talking about here. So when glucocorticoids are released from the adrenal gland, they down-regulate the HPA axis. And they do that at the level of the hypothalamus and the anterior pituitary, which you see there, but they also do it at the level of the hippocampus. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the hippocampus in a minute. So a lot of the dysfunctions that are caused by a lot of stress, high-intensity stress or chronic stressors, are related to the disruption of the negative feedback mechanism that can ultimately lead to prolonged HPA axis activation, right? So if this gets screwed up and you're not getting it turned down and you just keep on kicking out the cortisol, that's what we're talking about potentially is a problem there. Or if you just kept turning it down and turning it down, then ultimately cortisol, there wouldn't be any cortisol, and that could be where Salier kind of came up with that exhaustion thing, but that's probably not the case exactly. All right, more to come on that later. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about the hypothalamus, the pituitary, and the adrenal gland. So the hypothalamus, and I'll show you a picture in a minute, is located just beneath the thalamus, and again, it's an interface between the central nervous system and the endocrine system, as we said before. It receives signals that basically monitor internal functions like our circadian rhythm, like our appetite, body temperature, thirst, as well as external threat perception. External threats, the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the prefrontal cortex send that kind of information to the hypothalamus. And the job of the hypothalamus, for lack of a better term, is it's kind of this global threat assessor. And that should be in quotes because that's, I believe, what Thomas Gilliams wrote that about the hypothalamus. So here's a little picture of the hypothalamus and the different nuclei. So we've got the paraventricular nuclei there in the top one is the paraventricular nuclei. And then you have the supraoptic nuclei. I mentioned that a little while ago. The paraventricular nuclei is a big player here, and it's getting all sorts of signals from the brain, from the hippocampus, from the amygdala, from the prefrontal cortex, from the locus coeruleus, from the brainstem, all those, they send signals to the paraventricular nuclei, right? And there's other places within the hypothalamus also that sends signals to the hypothalamus. Each of these signals seems to have its own kind of characteristic sort of persona, if you will, that determines how the paraventricular nuclei responds to it. So it's not like every signal elicits the exact same response. So each signal is a little bit different, and that's because they're a little bit different, that will determine how the paraventricular nuclei responds. There are neurons, in the paraventricular nuclei that release CRH, which we just talked about. And a little bit of AVP, but mostly CRH. So the CRH-releasing neurons in the paraventricular nuclei are responsible for releasing the most of that CRH that we were just talking about. The hypothalamus, of course, is controlled by negative feedback, specifically the paraventricular nuclei. It turns out that there's receptors for glucocorticoids on the paraventricular nuclei. So when cortisol is high, cortisol binds those receptors on the paraventricular nuclei, that then mediates the release of additional CRH. Turns out that there are also glucocorticoid receptors in other parts of the brain that also indirectly influence the release of CRH. And even more interestingly, maybe, there are CRH receptors that have been found outside of the brain, right? So we were talking about CRH before binding being released from the hypothalamus and traveling to the pituitary, but it turns out that there are CRH receptors that are outside of the brain, and they're notably in the digestive tract, in the skin, and the cardiovascular tissues. And what we know is the gut gets really profoundly influenced by stress, which we'll talk about. It's very strongly implicated in irritable bowel syndrome, as well as all sorts of other irritable bowel disease and irritable bowel syndrome. And so kind of the characteristic stress responses at the gut are probably driven by the fact that these receptors are outside of are also in the GI tract, also in the skin. So the skin is an area where we see a lot of stress-related conditions, and the cardiovascular tissues. So we talked a little bit about some cardiovascular disease and all that earlier. All right. I want to mention the amygdala, the hippocampus, and the prefrontal cortex. So the amygdala, I think some people call this the amygdala. I say the amygdala. I don't know. That's how I was taught. But either way, I think amygdala sounds better. So the amygdala is one of two almond-shaped nuclei in the temporal lobe. I don't have a picture of it here, but I showed you a picture of this earlier, and I posted a little thing on the Khan Academy amygdala. He talked about this and showed you some pictures. It's part of the limbic system. Sorry for that typo. I don't know how I missed that. And kind of the claim to fame of the amygdala is it's responsible for interpreting emotional signals. Also fear, memory consolidation, conditioning to fear. The amygdala seems to be it seems to be a player in that. The amygdala influences the stress response by signaling through the paraventricular nuclei and also the locus coeruleus norepinephrine system, as well as the hippocampus. The hippocampus is part of the limbic system as well, as we already know. It's interesting. The hippocampus seems to be responsible for the formation of new memories. Also, like the ability, it's responsible for the ability to capture the emotional interpretation that corresponds to the event. That's kind of important. So what we do know is acute and chronic stress inhibits the formation of new memories, as well as the ability to retrieve memories. And this is something that's pretty well established at this point. So stress really, especially chronic stress, really plays a number on our ability to form memories and also to kind of like interpret the emotional component that corresponds to events, which is something I think that's like pretty exclusively human, although I don't know that for certain, but it seems to be a big part of human behavior. Okay, the prefrontal cortex is responsible for controlling our executive functions of the brain. Those are things like decision-making, planning, social interaction, short-term memory, problem-solving, that kind of stuff, the executive functions. And we do know that stress-induced behavioral disorders are thought to be driven a lot by glucocorticoid and catecholamine effects on this part of the brain. So fascinating, all this stuff. All right, so we're going to talk about the pituitary, and I'm going to get less detailed for the last bit of this, because the pituitary, we could spend all day talking about the pituitary. But the pituitary, for our purposes here in the HPA axis, is kind of a relay station that's going to convert neuroendocrine outputs from the hypothalamus, which are CRH and AVP, but mostly CRH, into hormonal signals, ultimately for the endocrine glands or organs. So let me show you a picture of, of all of this kind of a deal. So here you have, on this picture, you have, up at the top, you have the hypothalamus. And we actually have everything we've been talking about. On the left, you see in that box that says hypothalamus, you see the direct control by the nervous system. That'd be the sympathetic nervous system. So we've got the sympathoadrenal medullary system on the far left. And you see that neuron is going, traveling to the adrenal medulla. And the adrenal medulla will then secrete epinephrine and norepinephrine into the blood. Now we have the control of the really indirect control through the release of regulatory hormones. A regulatory hormone is going to be released into that portal system, and it's going to be delivered to the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland, and it's going to cause the pituitary gland to secrete another hormone into the blood. So there's all sorts of hypothalamic hormones that do that, but the only one we talked about was CRH for the purposes of the stress response. And then for our purposes, the hormone that's going to be released from the anterior pituitary that's going to influence the adrenal cortex is ACTH, which you can see up there. It's the first one. That's again adrenocorticotropic hormone. But then look at all the other things that could potentially be influenced by stress. So we have thyroid stimulating hormone being released by the anterior pituitary. It stimulates the thyroid to make thyroid hormones. We have growth hormone that causes our tissues to grow, but it also causes the liver to secrete something called somatomedins, which are insulin-like growth factors. We have prolactin, which stimulates our mammary glands. We have FSH and LH, which stimulate the FSH is kind of in charge of stimulating the testes of a male and the ovaries of a female to produce estrogen in a female and testosterone in a male. Luteinizing hormone is responsible for spermatogenesis. Luteinizing hormone in women is oogenic, or, well, it's kind of complicated, but both FSH and LH, oogenesis and estrogen and progesterone and function. Then, so that's the anterior pituitary and the hormones of the anterior pituitary, all they're kind of in those purple boxes. Then we've got in gray the intermediate, and that's gonna, the intermediate tissue of the pituitary releases a melanocyte stimulating hormone, MSH, which stimulates our melanocytes in our skin, which are the cells that give us pigment. The melanocytes seem to do other things too, but we're not super clear on all of that. And then the posterior pituitary, the back of the pituitary, we have antidiuretic hormone and oxytocin being released. Antidiuretic hormone and AVP are the same, kind of oftentimes referred to as the same thing. So AVP stimulates the anterior and the pituitary, posterior pituitary a little bit. But for our purposes, sorry, that's overkill. All we really are focusing on is the adrenal gland. So ACTH is the player. So there's a lot. There's a lot of things. You don't want to screw up your pituitary gland, clearly, right? Things go off the rails when the pituitary gland gets screwed up. And the stress response, so there's a couple things that we know. As people get older, the signaling and endocrine functions of the pituitary gland get altered. They get turned down a little bit. And this affects the entire endocrine system, which kind of makes sense. And it also accelerates, and it's also accelerated by stress. So that's something I have noticed, and I don't know if you guys have noticed, and if we were in a class, I could talk about this right now with you, but I have noticed that as people age, and it's been something that I've kind of known for a long time, but I didn't really understand until I kind of dove into this and really started figuring this out. As people age, they become a lot less resilient to stress. Like, older people seem to get really stressed out really easily, and I always was like, I never really got it. I was like, you'd think with age, you'd be more relaxed, and you, like, with a lot of the stuff you would be kind of be able to deal with, but it seems like little things are incredibly stressful. And I think this is it. So I wonder if it's this, if that is worsened in people who had significant stresses as younger people and then became less resilient. And then as they age, they get even less resilient. So that's something that I am curious about. All right, the very last thing I'm going to talk to you guys about, because I'm sure your brains are about ready to explode, are the adrenal glands. Now, we've talked about them circuitously already, but the adrenal glands, there they are. They're sitting on top of your kidneys. They're cute little things. They sit right up there like little hats. There's the outer part called the adrenal medulla, the adrenal cortex. The inner part is called the adrenal medulla. The outer part, the adrenal cortex, is broken down into zones. You don't need to memorize these, but each zone secretes a different hormone, and I'll show you which ones come from which in a minute. The innermost one closest to the medulla is called the zona reticularis. The one in the middle is called the zona fasciculata, and the one on the outside is called the zona glomerulosa. So here you have the different hormones that are secreted from each of the zones of the adrenal cortex. So remember, the one on the inside was the zona reticularis, and so all adrenal glands start from a precursor molecule, which is cholesterol. Cholesterol is the precursor for all adrenal hormones, glucocorticoids. Cortisol then gets converted into a molecule called, or a signaling molecule called pregnenolone. And then from pregnenolone, it goes into the different zones. So the reticularis, we'll start with there all the way on the right, reticularis, the pregnenolone, gets converted to something called 17-hydroxypregnenolone, which you don't need to remember, but ultimately that's going to get converted either into mostly from the zona reticularis, mostly into DHEA. You can see there is potentially a little bit of cortisol, but that's not the main production of cortisol. The main producer of cortisol comes from the fasciculata, zona fasciculata. And humans will either produce cortisol or corticosterone. The 17 from pregnenolone that can go to make cortisol, pardon me, that pregnenolone gets converted also into 17-hydroxypregnenolone. And then from there it goes to cortisol. That final conversion happens into the mitochondria of our cell. The other option is to convert the pregnenolone into progesterone in the zona fasciculata, which then ultimately would get converted into corticosterone, and that happens in the endoplasmic reticulum. This is not a big deal in humans, but it's a big deal in rodents. Corticosterone is the main glucocorticoid in rodents, if you remember. In humans, it's not a big pathway. And then finally, in the zona glomerulosa, which is the outermost portion, that's where we are going to go from cortisol outside to pregnenolone, and then ultimately into progesterone, corticosterone, and then finally into aldosterone. That happens in that last little conversion happens in the mitochondria of our cells. So those are our adrenal gland hormones. The cortisol is the one we're focusing on. So that was kind of a lot. I was going to keep going and start to talk a little bit more about, I think that's plenty for this week. So that was a lot of detail and a lot of science, and I don't want you to be freaked out by that, because that's not my intention. But I really think, like, to really understand stress, we have to understand the science behind it. We got to understand this physiology. So we're going to, you know, again, you don't have to go wild with memorizing all of this stuff, but I do want you to know the basics of the HPA axis, what the players are. I want you to know what negative feedback is. I want you to know about the sympathetic medullary system, locus coeruleus, norepi, just that it exists, just because it's so interesting. So you might need to watch this again. Certainly shoot some questions to me. And we're going to pick it up next week with a little bit more fun stuff. All right. Have a great day or night, depending on where you are when you're listening to this.